I'm Matty Mainwaring and I'm 4-0.
I'm Aky Karim and I'm 10-0.
Matthew Hatton, trainer and manager of both of these two guys.
And you know me, I'm the good looking one, Aky Karim, and this is Boxmania's weekly show, and we're down here at Metro Fitness. Now, Matthew Hatton, firstly, thanks for letting us come down here today.
Oh, my pleasure.
Thank you very much, and you've got two fantastic fighters here who may not be that well known yet to the wider public, so tell us a little bit about your fighters.
Well, we'll start with Matty on the far left there, former professional footballer. Matt will tell you more about that in a little bit, but been at some really good clubs. I started off personal training, Matt, probably about 2 years ago now. He was a boxing fan. I could tell as soon as I spoke to him, he knew everything about boxing. He knew nearly as much as me.
Right.
I started off personal training, Matt. Could see he had Matt's one of these guys. He was a really good athlete. He'd probably be good at most things. But when I took him on the pads, I was really shocked and surprised how good he was in the knowledge he had, to be fair. So anyway, we started training more and more together. Matt showed more and more of an interest. He was still being paid for his football at the time, so it was difficult. So then I organised some sparring for Matty, which he was keen to do. And I was just absolutely shocked at the ability he's got, really. And even when the board come down, because obviously it's quite a strange story, he's never boxed amateur, no licensed experience, no white collar. So when I took him to the board to apply for his licence, they said, well, we'll come down and take a look at him. And the guy from the board just couldn't believe it. He was flabbergasted at the ability. And Matt struggled a little bit with injuries. You know, he's been pro about 18 months now, struggled a little bit with injuries. But if we can put those injuries behind us and get a bit of momentum going, the ability Matthew's got is phenomenal, really. He's a future star. Adam again. Adam had 22 amateur fights. Mm-hmm. Again, come on the boxing class with a couple of his friends. He'd had a little bit of a break from boxing. Started coming to get back into the fitness, really. Again, I spotted that he had a little bit of ability. Give him an opportunity to start coming training with me. I was so impressed with him, with his attitude. When he first came on the classes, he was carrying a lot of weight. His fitness was terrible, to be honest.
Right.
I couldn't believe he used to box, to be fair. But I said, start coming in a little bit more with me, which he did. He really started dedicating himself, really started putting, and was just so impressed with his attitude, how his fitness come on so quickly. And again, started him sparring, showing that he's got a lot of natural ability, turned professional, and he's just not looked back since, really. He's going from strength to strength. Been professional 18 months now, put 10 quick wins together, and we're moving Adam forward this year. Like I say, he's been so impressive. You know, I get compliments all the time how well he's looking. And, his 11th fight coming up on the 10th of February. Mm-hmm. So Adam will be challenging for a title this year, definitely.
Brilliant. All right, and Adam, so what's it like working with the team now? You guys seem like a really good, like, tight team. You obviously get on really well.
Yeah, it's good. I really enjoy it, coming to the gym, training with Matty, obviously training with Matt as well. Enjoy it.
Yeah.
Really good.
Nice. And in terms of people that haven't sort of seen you fight just yet, what's your sort of style? Can you describe yourself as a fighter?
I reckon I'm a come forward fighter. I can box on the back foot. I've got a good boxing brain. Can outbox people, most people.
Nice.
I've got to come in there because I'd been watching, but I've been involved in boxing for years now, at different levels, and Adam has got such an attractive style to watch. Like you say, he is a little bit of unheard of at the minute, and he has flown under the radar, and that's the way we've played it, really. He's been learning all the time, getting fitter, but people will know all about this man this year. He's got such a great style, such an attractive style to watch. He's a fantastic body puncher. And as a boxing fan, I enjoy watching him train in the gym, watching him spar, so people know all about this man this year.
Fantastic. And in terms of your own aspirations, Adam, obviously, I know you're obviously a very respectful fighter. You're not going to talking
such respectful people.
But where do you see yourself? Where does this journey, where do you want it to go, this journey?
I believe I'll go all the way, mate. I won't be sat here now. I won't waste my time. I'll be out with my mates every weekend, enjoying myself.
And you mentioned earlier that you were going to be campaigning at the 135 division.
Yeah, after this fight, after I beat Lee Connolly, I'll be fighting at lightweight.
Brilliant, that's fantastic. And let's just go to the end here. We've got this good-looking chap on the end here, Mr. Matty over here. You used to be a model, that's right. Is that correct? And an ex-footballer?
No, I am. I'm not a footballer no more. I'm Matt full-time, but I'm a model now. I'm only model for...
He likes to get that one in there.
It's 3 years now I've been modelling.
Where does a model decide, you know what, actually, I'm going to go and put my looks on the line here and become a professional fighter?
You know what, it's an incentive.
I think I inspire him. He's not moving my eyes, to be honest.
No comment.
I keep telling Matthew I'm available for modelling work. Well, he's not, you know, he works somehow, he's not come up with anything.
Yeah, your phone never rings, doesn't it?
Oh, no. I have to keep checking the battery.
Yeah. Are you obviously like dead serious about the fight game then? To make such a leap over?
Yeah, of course. I played football since being a baby, since being 2 years old, since I can walk. I do love football and I'll always love football, but you know, being brutally honest, boxing's my passion. Mm. It always has been. I can't describe how much I love the sport. You know, I used to come home from training and just watch fights, put a fight in, watch it. Tommy Hearns, Mayweather, Tyson, Riggan down all these fighters, and I just love to learn. And my knowledge was quite good because I watched that much, but I've got Matt to thank for everything I've learned, because I was a blank slate, you know, no amateur fights, never. Really, I've hit a bag, you know, stuff like that, but I've never had any fights or anything, so yeah, I just love it. And I think once you look, you know, when you love something, you're receptive to it. Yeah.
It's a remarkable story as well, that transition. And also, you're big for a 154-pound fighter, or coming down to 154 pounds. That could be a real advantage for you. When you go into the ring, do you often find yourself, you know, you've got to reach advantage over your opponents and things like that?
Yeah, I do, yeah. I mean, at the minute, fighting at 160, because we're weighing the other day, but me and Matt have had a chat, and I haven't had it. I've been near 11 stone before now without really pushing it. So I think that's what I will be when the fights get longer, when the camps get longer. I think I will be a light middleweight. I can't think of anybody apart from probably Prince Aaron that's taller than me.
Yeah, we mentioned Matty Ryan as well, didn't we?
Matty Ryan, about the same height, maybe an inch taller. Yeah. Other than that, yeah, I do find I've got a reach advantage. But my main attribute is my speed, and I think reach with speed is dangerous together.
Yeah, exactly. And you're both out together on the same show, is that right?
Okay.
Is it the 10th of February?
10th of February.
Right, okay, Britton. Can you tell us a little bit about your opponents, guys? Adam, can you tell us a little bit about your opponents?
Yeah, I'm fighting Lee Connolly. He's a good, strong, tough opponent. And got a bit of experience, hasn't he, Matt?
Yeah. And like I say, just touching on Matt there, I've got so much admiration for Matt, because, like you say, Matt still being paid for his football. Mm. I explained to him about the boxing, how it's difficult early on running around selling tickets, not on big money for the fights. And the fact that he gave up football shows how much he loves the sport. And again, you know, speaking about Adam's ability before, Matthew is so fit. So fit, he's such a really good actor. He lives his life so clean, doesn't drink. He's just, he's a bit of a gym rat. He loves being in the gym, loves training. And like I say, phenomenally fast, so fit, so fast. Again, another attractive fighter to watch in the ring. So, but the fact that Matthew was willing to give up his football to take up the hardest of all sports, I think is fantastic. Yeah. And again, like I say, that both the guys fighting February 10th, got Lee Connolly for Adam, who's a very strong, tough fighter, unbeaten in his last three fights. But again, we've spoken about Adam and how we want to push him forward, and how I believe this year we're ready for a title fight. These are the fights that he's got to win, and win impressively to show that he is ready for that next level.
We're talking about English title there?
Yeah. I don't see any reason why Adam can't be challenging for an English title by the end of the year.
Yeah, fantastic. Guys, are you on social media?
Yeah. Yeah.
Right, listen, now is your time to shout out your social media, because I know it's dead important these days, so why don't we start with Matty then, shout out.
Yeah, I'm not on Facebook, I'm on Twitter, it's Matty_main, so you can follow me and get all my info, all my fight info, details, tickets, etc. on there. Also on Instagram, that's MattyMain90, you can get the info on there. I put it up regularly, you know, 2-3 times a week, promoting my fights and letting everybody know what's in the post.
Yeah, you can follow me on Twitter, AdamHague4, and Instagram, AdamHague1993.
And has the gym got a handle or anything like that? Or?
Yeah, just Metro Fitness on Twitter. We haven't got an Instagram page, actually. That should be started early this year. But yeah, you can follow us on Twitter, at Metro Fitness.
Fantastic. And we're going to get some footage of the guys training later, so that's something to look forward to as well. Is there anything you would want to say on a closing note about the boys, about the upcoming fight?
No, I think we've covered it there. Like you say, I'll let the guys finish. I've got high expectations for both these two. Adam, you know, said he thinks he can go all the way. Same with Matthew. You know, I think if you're unbeaten in this sport, you've got to aim for the stars, aren't you? You've got to aim for the top. And both of these boys have got fantastic natural ability. And with my help, I don't see why they can't get to the top, either one of them.
Right, I hope you've enjoyed that, guys. This is Matthew Hatton down at the Metro Fitness with his two fantastic pro fighters. And I'm telling you something, they're coming for you. Power! Okay, we're down here at FLF Performance Centre in Manchester for the Sweet Science segment. You know who this guy is. It's the coach, James Largy. Now, this little interesting segment we're going to do today is about the importance of rest. In particular, how can you translate that to the importance of rest for a boxer?
Cool, very, very good question, as always.
As all you know.
One of the big things that I've come across, especially over this time of year, with it being Christmas, New Year's Eve, sort of the festive holidays, is boxers more so in particular, they tend to brag about how hard they work. For me, boxers train too much anyway. So if you're training 2-3 times a day, and then you're also going to be training during times when you would typically celebrate with your family and have some time off and have some downtime, then more than likely, 9 times out of 10, you're going to be burning the candle at both ends. What I tell them to do is kind of take note of what numbers they're getting in the gym, what their energy levels are like, score that, and also get some feedback from the coach. See how the coach is assessing the performance, and then go from there and decide on whether it's better for the career going into the new year to have actually some time off or to train on Christmas Day, because it might not necessarily be beneficial.
So in terms of time off, how much rest time do you think a fighter needs, maybe between camps or just in general for optimum recovery for the body?
What I would say is it will all depend on where the boxer is and when they're going to be fighting. So if you've got a boxer who's got a fight in January, I'm not going to tell him to go and eat a load of mince pies on Christmas Day. But that being said, if you've not got a fight date lined up and you're going into December, take some time off. Boxing is a very, very militant lifestyle and sport. People tend to, when they're in the zone and nobody can kind of interact with them or connect with them other than anything to do with boxing. So really you should take advantage of this time now. Go into the new year with peace of mind, knowing that you've managed to spend some time with your family and you can go into it full steam ahead. You took a little bit of time back. That will also build up your reserves and give you that energy to attack it, really.
So let's talk about some of the physical effects of overtraining. What can you give us?
Well, like we mentioned on episode 2, I think it was.
We've done so many, but I can't remember which episode it was.
Sex drive is one of the ones that I tend to get the most honesty out of a boxer with, because it's very, very hard. You speak to most boxers and they are trained with the psychology to be hard. There's no weakness. So even if you're tired, you don't show it. So if you can ask them sort of questions that will take them out of their comfort zone and be like, wow, why is this guy asking the question? They might be less prone to give you an automatic answer.
Okay.
So that's a really, really good one that I tend to tell coaches to ask their trainers.
So if they're overtraining, they'll have a lower sex drive?
Typically, yeah. The adrenal glands will be a little bit flat. They will tend to have a reverse cortisol curve. And what I mean by that is they will be tired in the morning, wired at night, so they might end up struggling to switch off at night.
Right.
So what you should be is you should be awake, alert. The moment you get up, you should be alert, and then you should start to drop off towards the end of the night and be a little bit more relaxed.
Okay, and final question then, does active rest help performance in the ring?
100%. Active rest for me is the first stage that a boxer who overtrains should go to. It would be ideal for me to say, okay, Aky, you train too much, 3 sessions a day, you sleep very, very minimal, stop. Because they won't do it. The majority of boxers tend to train, who train too much, when the coach tells them to take a day off, they don't. So the one thing I would say is do an active recovery session. If you've got some kids or cousins or nephews or whatever, go to the park, have a bit of fun. Use active recovery that way. Again, you're connecting with your family and loved ones, and you know you might even be able to have an ice cream afterwards.
There you go. Listen, go to the park and have some fun.
That's the one.
We're here at FLF Performance Centre in Manchester. We're talking about recovery and rest for boxers. Power! I'm Aky Karim. I'm here with British Boxers website, and I got the pleasure of being joined by Mr. Sean Krool on my right and Mr. Michael Gomez Jr. on my left. Now, Michael, you're quite an interesting character in boxing. I mean, I love sort of like following your story. You've had an interesting and I suppose a difficult road into boxing. How do you think that's affected you now that you're sort of a professional fighter?
You know what, I think at first, a lot of people, when I first took, like when I was an amateur, I was just another kid, I was just the amateur, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I was just, and then when I turned pro, I had my first fight, you know, on a Frank Warren show at the MEN.
Yeah.
And I stopped the kid and I looked quite decent doing it, and then a lot of people were saying, oh, he's, you know, he's Michael Gomez Jr. now, all of a sudden I've gone from just an average kid in the amateurs to, you know, a professional son, and it sort of dawned on me. And then, you know, a lot of people on Twitter, then I was just the target quite often. I was getting, you know, people like, oh, your dad'll be this, your dad's that, and, you know, don't get me wrong, I give my dad grief as well, but, yeah. You know, when you're getting off other people, you've gone from nothing to, like, people, you know, hating on you, it sort of dawns on you, and to what, like, after my second fight, it sort of, like, put me off boxing for a bit, and then,
yeah.
You know, now I'm sort of, you know, it's not about anyone else now, it's about me. And I've
when you say it put you off boxing, what do you mean, why did it put you off this your second fight?
No, obviously my second fight, I had a couple of injuries and stuff, but it was like, you know, I expected professional boxing to be, you know, just professional boxing. Every kid wants to be a professional boxer,
yeah,
don't they?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I didn't expect to deal with, you know, being, you know, from just a kid to someone else's, you know, someone's son who you've got to live up to his expectations.
Well, it's interesting that, because, I mean, obviously you're making your own legacy now. Do you feel that sort of weight of pressure, the fact that, you know, your dad was a exceptionally popular and exceptionally successful professional fighter? Does that added pressure for you, or are you trying to detach yourself from that?
That's what I mean. At first it did. I was like trying to disguise that it didn't, but really deep down I'm thinking, you know, I've got a lot. If I don't live up to at least half of it,
yeah.
You know, I'm going to be known as the kid that, you know, was nowhere near as good.
Yeah.
But now I've realised that, you know, he did what he did. I believe I'm going to go on to do a lot better.
Okay. Yeah, well, let's switch the attention to focus on you. I mean, your career's, you know, you've got a really good starting point. You're undefeated. You're 6-0. Now, we mentioned earlier, we just had a little chat earlier, and you said, you know, the stoppages are going to come, but you've basically been fighting people that are heavier than you, realistically, haven't you?
Yeah, for some weird reason, at my weight, it's been hard to get me matched. For whatever reason, I've always ended up getting an opponent. I've never had an opponent within 3 days' notice. It's always been minute, and, you know, being the head case that I am, well, a fight's a fight, you know, put the heavyweight in front of me, you know, I'm going to go up there, I'm going to get paid, and I'm going to fight until I win, and that's what I'll do.
Now, you've got this, like, let's talk about this now. I mean, it's a little bit controversial, but you've been known at times as one of the bad boys of boxing, right? What is it now that you think's refocused you to move away from that sort of bad boy image?
I'm going to keep the bad boy image because I like that, you know, the main thing that motivates me now is all the haters, you know, constantly messaging, you know, people like my coach Sean and stuff, saying, oh, he's a waste of time, oh, he's not going to turn up, he's not going to do this, he's not going to do that. Well, we'll see. You know, I believe in 12 to 18 months' time, when I've got a fair few titles behind me, all them people that are going to be sat there ringside, like, oh, I was that kid. Got there, and I'm sat here still hating on him.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. And you just mentioned Sean Krool there. What's it like actually working with Sean down at the Fight Factory? You seem to have a really good, solid relationship being built here.
I've never come across someone like Sean before, and it's hard. He doesn't even give you that little smile. He sat there on the circuit, just give me some sort of emotion thrive off, and he just, and that makes me want it even more. And he just stood there like, you know, he's just hard. He didn't look it to me.
Sean, what's your take on this? I mean, obviously a lot of people have been saying to you, you know, perhaps don't work with Michael because you know things we just mentioned there. What was your approach to that?
So I know Mikey from a time back. I mean, when I trained Alex Rutter, they've had a few spars, and obviously being involved with Pat, always being around Pat's gym and everything else. So that's where I know Mikey from. Mm-hmm. And truthfully, I think he has a lot of talent, and unfortunately, not everyone's blessed with a popular dad like him. And a lot of people look for that, you know, that link with boxing. He's got it. He's got the talent, he's got everything else. And I mean, we've had a chat ourselves over the last few months. And I said to you, Mikey, forget about everything else that's happened with your dad and people hating on you. It's your time now. I mean, he's got passion for the game.
Mm.
He's just got to take all that energy and all that passion, everything that he's got for boxing, and just transfer it into his own game, concentrate on himself, And I think he's a fighter. Obviously, it's in his genes, you know, boxing's in his genes.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Why not capitalize on everything else? And listen, if his dad is there, his dad's legacy is there for him to work on it. Why not use it? But also use your talent and his determination and want to prove everyone wrong and his passion for the game. And I'm here. I can see what he's got, but I'm not going to try and milk it for it because I believe in him showing us that he has got it and he wants it himself.
Yeah.
So when he says that I've got no passion, no expression on my face, that is because I can see there's much more to come from what he's just showing me. And every day he's been in the gym, and this is honestly, I've seen every session, I've seen a better Mikey turn up and a better Mikey turn up. So if I've been there trying to milk the situation, then obviously I'm playing into his hands, and then he thinks, okay, let me just relax a bit because I can see Sean is, you know, he's buying into what I've got. I can see there's much more there. I've been around the world.
Yeah, man.
I've seen it. I've seen it.
Maybe a lot. To be the things that we had quite a few chats, you know, after training. I like to stay behind the chat and stuff. And he's made me believe, you know, there's a lot. I've got a lot of talent. I just need to start, you know, using it. And you know, he's made me when I'm not in the gym, I'm at home watching boxing now. I used to, you know, obviously I watch it on a weekend because that's what you do. But I never used to in a week, you know, go home and like study, like, oh wow, you know, I'm learning this in the gym. I'll learn it off someone who's elite level and see how they do it, and then put it into my style. And now, and then I'm out when I'm running, I'm thinking of boxing. Everything's about boxing now.
Sounds like the fire's been lit, to be honest with me.
I can't say I've never been hungry because that would be disrespectful, but you know, there's always been something like getting in the way from when I've started. Obviously, when I started out, it was my, you know, getting over the fact that I've gone from just a kid to getting over my dad, and then the last three fights, it was. I had a little boy and stuff, I was living with my dad, and things was a bit, you know, went a bit crazy as people know. So it went, you know, and they had the more blocks, and then I had 7 months out of the gym, you know, got boxing, went, you know, I had my last fight and the James London in the show, fantastic show, and I got that hunger back, and then obviously that's when me and Sean sat down and said, well, you know, it's rather now or never. You know, in the next 12 to 18 months, if I can't dedicate myself and, you know, start proving what I'm worth, you know, even 18 months if I'm still at where I am, I may as well go and be a builder. Well, there's easier things to do, so if I can't start making it work now, then, you know, just forget it.
So in terms of like your actual navigating a path for next year, we talked about English titles then, so that's something that could be on the agenda in the near future, English titles.
I think, well, I need...
And just let us know what weight would you be thinking of doing that at?
I'm a super bantamweight. You know, we can make bantamweight if the opportunities come, but right now we're going to hit the super bantamweights, and I think I need one fight, get confidence back, because I've not boxed for a lot, you know, I've only boxed once this year. I need one fight, just get confidence back, you know, get an easy, and then I'm ready for, I want to pick up.
And listen, this guy's ready for anyone as well, he'll fight anyone.
I want to pick up maybe the English, by the end of the year, I want to have at least the English title and some sort of, you know, maybe the Commonwealth or one of these international belts.
Or even fight for the British, why not?
You know, why not? Let's see. I want some titles.
Let's see how it is over the next two fights, and we could even go for the British. I think, honestly, I've been around a lot of fighters, and we've got a good camp here, and I think they're all going to rub off on each other.
Yeah.
And Mikey, he's got the talent. He's been, even when he's not, he's been sparring high quality fighters that I've gone for. He's been in the ring with Paul Butler with sparring. I know, obviously, you can't go off sparring, but you understand what I'm saying? He's got it in his genes, as I was saying. He's been around boxing all his life. So it's not just like any other fighter or any young kid just coming off the street. This is what he lived, breathed, everything is boxing with him. So it's time now that he's got to believe in it himself, and he's got to just get that passion for the game. He's got a daughter,
a son,
so that's
your daughter as well.
That's another little something to encourage him to, you know.
100%. All right, listen, man, just to close this off then, would you look at the camera and tell the fighters in your division why they need to watch out for Michael Gomez Jr.?
Well, the fact is, super bantamweight division right now is dead. It's boring, no one's interested. Now Scott Quigg and Carl Frampton have moved up onto featherweight, and you know, the world scene, super bantamweight, no one cares about it, it's boring, and I'm here to make it back alive again.
Yeah, you heard it here first.
Shout out to all my teammates as well, Fight Factory.
Fight Factory, watch out. Watch out. I'm Aky Karim, British Boxers website, Michael Gomez Jr., Sean Krool, Fight Factory in Manchester. Power!
Your next fight, you went to Belgium and you fought Franco Weyama.
Weyama, yeah. Listen.
Lost on points, but I think everyone who
I won that fight. Believe me, I won that fight. I had that guy rocking and rolling, you know what I mean? Actually, he'd have got a draw or a win there. Like I said, you find people's backyard, you completely have to knock him out, as I say, in most cases.
Again, you know, it didn't deter you. You come back, you defeated Terry Dixon on points.
Well, that's it. When they see me lost, you lose. They see, the funny thing is, up-and-coming fighters, they always want to fight losers. That's what they do. That's no disrespect to the journeyman of the business. That's what's keeping the sport alive, you know what I mean? And that's what happened where Derek Dixon seen me lost two fights on the run, I think. Is it after a fight? Was it 2-1
fight? Yeah, you've lost the two, yeah.
Yeah, that's what they've done. Yeah, so they know, well, he's lost that one, let's take him on.
Yeah.
But I still had ambition then, you see.
He was unbeaten. But
he was unbeaten. Mm. Yeah, and the fight was short. Again, Franco Wanyama, that was short notice. Again, come to Terry Dixon, that was short notice. So you have to take fights in short notice. And this time I was determined to win this particular fight, you know what I mean?
You was back on the road again, went over to Monaco.
Yeah,
And you, the Ugandan southpaw, Yor Davis.
I think that's the first southpaw fight, but I got beat, put my hands up on him, he caught me with a good punch. But I think it was on Mike McCallum's show. And after when Mike McCallum fought, everyone virtually went home. So as I went there, it was like an empty place. It was down, you went up for it. You know what I mean? So he caught him a good shot and it stopped me again. I used it as a learning fight. I didn't want to lose.
He was a decent fighter. I mean, you've had some good wins up to that point, you know, some deserved wins, some undeserved losses, some controversial ones. But like you say, you've seen it all as a, you know, learning your trade. A big fight for you, 1991, Nicky Piper. again, another upcoming prospect. He drew with Morris, of course.
Yeah, he did.
Before that, and I remember Morris telling me the story that they rang Phil Martin up and said, you know, have you got with Carl Thompson ready? He said, well, he's not ready at the moment. He's just been on holiday, but little did they know you'd been in the gym and you was an ultimate professional as far as your conditioning, your training, and you shocked everyone that night and stopped him, Nicky Piper.
Well, Phil was good at telling little stories like that, but I didn't want to take that fight because of the sole reason that Nicky Piper had the fastest knockout at that particular time, and he fought Morris and he had got a draw, and I said, no, it's no way, because it was a week's notice I think I had for that fight, and I thought, I don't want to do that because I didn't think I was fit enough. And then when I heard about the knockdowns, I went out and got myself a pair of glasses because I was going to cover my eyes up because I knew what kind of fight it was going to be. You know what the story is, I stopped in the third round, so that's where things actually start to happen, you know.
And you was light heavyweight then, I mean, the first part you got up to that fight. Was it after that then you decided to move up to cruiserweight?
I think I did it from when I was Ashton Crawford, to tell the truth, because it was just too much. I was just taking, where I was supposed to be losing fat, I was losing muscle tissue. So after I lost against Ashton Crawford, got some other problem, because I come down to around 12-4, I was around 12-4, 12-6, I think, for the Ashton Crawford fight. So after I lost, and then I think, no, because I took Nicky Piper, you're right, because I took Nicky Piper, I probably would have been around 13 stone or something like that, because they got me on short notice.
He fought Morris at light heavyweight, yeah.
Yeah, he fought Morris at light heavyweight, so I would have been that way. So he wouldn't have fought Morris dead on if it were a championship fight, so he wouldn't have fought Morris at 12-7. So he would have been like in a 13 anyway, so it weren't much weight different, but their excuses was still giving, oh, so much weight, you know what I mean? This is what you find, people make up excuses, you see.
I mean, after that, then, Carl, you became British champion. So, you know, getting into the game and like you say, as a novice, really, coming into it, it wasn't, and you had it having them losses.
Yeah.
And then to win the British title, you know, you stopped Steve Lewisham in the eighth.
Uh-huh.
British cruiserweight champion. I mean, what an achievement from what you've just told me.
And I know, I mean, of course, I wouldn't have believed it because how my career was panning out after losing two fights. Going onward to the British title, I would never thought that would happen, and also I was one of the first champion. I think I was in champs camp, so I think I set the ball rolling really. And then success starts coming. Then Morris Corr, you had Paul Burke, and you had Frank Grant, and the bar starts going, you know, and it's like four British champion. I don't know if that was ever done in one camp at that particular time. I don't know if that was ever done, and I don't think it was. So it was a great achievement for the club, you know.
Yeah, Phil was great at what he did, and brilliant for boxing at the time and for the area and everything. Yeah. You know, what was your relationship like with Phil when you first met him? What did you think about Phil?
Well, it was a hard man. It's a hard man to please. He liked to get blood out of you and tears as well. He trained you hard. I think what I mean, I hope Morris don't mind me saying this, but he loved Morris, and I think he loved seeing Morris get the better of me. And I think that sort of, he edged me on to get a better of Morris, because I didn't want that. I mean, I remember when he was killing himself laughing when Morris was beating me up at stages. But I managed to turn it around, and it was great just for that to happen for me, you know what I mean?
Maybe that was kind of Phil's way of getting everybody to perform to the ultimate.
Maybe, but I think, because it weren't just me and Morris, we had to survive in that gym, and we had to hold our own at each other, and that's what kind of gym it was. Everyone was hungry, they all come up to, they want to be champions, and I don't know, we had a lot of fighters in them days, you know.
He knew the game well, Phil. He was a tough professional himself, wasn't he? So, so British champion. You know, how did your life then change at that point, and how was you looked on differently then as
it didn't change. It changed, obviously it changed because I was British champion, but if you're looking at a financial sense, it wasn't, because when I fought for that British title, I only got paid with £3,500 for that. So in a money sense, that didn't change. I mean, it wasn't, so you're just a British, you were a British champion, so you have to respect about what it represents for, what it was for, you know what I mean? So it was great to be a British champion.
And a nine fight and beat and run after that, so you pick up the WBC international title.
Yeah.
Arthur Stormy Weathers.
Yeah.
Great nickname like that. You stopped him in the second, that you won the European title in that time.
Yeah.
Massimil Duran.
Oh, wow, word.
In Italy, I mean, it was some turnaround, what a great period of your life and your boxing career that was.
Again, throughout my career, people have always been negative towards me, and after going over and fighting Massimil Duran, and where no one gave me a chance, it was it's a great feeling, you know, to prove people wrong in my career.
What do you recall about that period and them fights, you know, the championship fights?
Marcelino Duran, that was a hard fight. That guy was just out jabbing me again. And I remember, because I watched one or two of his fights, he always marks up and he caught something. And about the sixth round, he wasn't caught. He was looking pretty, and I thought, I'm not hurting this guy. And I went through him, and in the seventh round, I caught him. Now, that was the fuel, the memento to keep it going. And then come eighth round, because I was losing, there's no way I'm going to win the fight. So come eighth round, I put it on him, and I stopped him. I did one hell of a shot.
That was 1994.
You
know, but that was the year that you probably, you know, reflect on the bittersweet memories, because Phil passed away as well.
Yeah, that was, it was memories, but at the same time, we parted at that particular time. I'm not going to go into much details, the reason why. But then it was a Hakeem Tafer fight, and that was a hard one. That was one of my gullaby. Apart from Ezra Sellers, between them two fights, that was a hard fight. I was getting my backside kicked really in about Hakeem Tafer. He's thrown every shot. I remember him for the first three rounds, he's standing up in his corner. That's how much of an easy time he was having. I think I was saying, going back to my corner, please God, don't let me disgrace myself here. And I think he answered, and I'm bringing tears out, because that was a real one. That really toughened me up. And I think he answered my prayer and made me sit down in the fourth round. I knew I got him. Come the fifth round, I knocked him down. Come the sixth round, this shot was a beautiful shot. It's like time stood still for me to deliver this right uppercut. I've done a right uppercut and then a right hand over and just brought him down. Yes, But the fifth round, when I knocked him down, I thought, please stay down, stay down. I thought, oh, he got up again. Come the sixth round, I knew I had to go at him because he's going to come at me. I knew I had to go. It was like the sixth round was in a phone booth with both phones shot. Your turn, my turn, your turn. And like I said, the gap opened, time stood still. I threw me right uppercut and then right over the top. Down I went. I think I was a big scream. I think went down on my knee and thank God for that. And I could not believe it. You know, that was, I will never forget that fight.
You really had to search inside
yourself.
Yeah,
I really did. Right? I really, how much? That was a big heart. My heart, that's when I knew I had heart. And I think I've never been in such a hard fight like that one till I come to that one. And then came that with Sellers, that was a hard one because it was just big punches after big punches, you know?
Okay, thanks for watching that, guys. Hope you've enjoyed it. Thanks to everybody involved, Matthew Hatton, Adam Hague, we've had Matty Main, Coach James Largy, Carl Thompson, and of course Michael Gomez Jr. Listen, you don't want to miss our next show. I've seen what's going on, and we are spoiling you. Power!